And we are talking about how basically we went from shipping code about, say, once or twice a month to shipping code every single hour, and how the journey and how we got there. So, you know, a bit about Haptic itself. Haptic started out as a personal assistant application on the App Store. And from there, it's gone to a full-blown chatbot development platform. The app is still out there, going strong, one of the highest rated apps in India. The entire platform now processes about 1.2 million messages every single day. And we have more than 50 plus bots deployed now across multiple aspects of the business. So the B2B aspect, where we make chatbots and we deploy them directly for end consumers, for businesses. And the application itself, the Android and iOS apps, as well as those packages which are deployed in other partner apps like Times of India, Economic Times. So around across these, all of these applications, we have about a reach of say 20 million users, and given the DAU, that's another scale we see. So, you know, to give an idea of the problem that we faced when we were trying to build these bots, we were trying to build and ship features to the platform itself, I thought I'd talk, just touch briefly upon basically how the teams are organized. So you have certain teams over here which are working completely independently. Say the machine learning guys are working by themselves on the models and making, you know, the bots smarter, figuring out ways to build smarter chatbots. The apps team is shipping out the SDK, which kind of works independently of the chat models themselves, as well as there's certain product teams building out the chatbots, and they are shipping, each single team here is shipping its own set of code, its own set of features. So across the entire companies, there's about 7 or 8 different feature lines that are being built, multiple bots are being built at the same time. And everyone has sort of their own release cycles, their own set of timelines, everything that they need to ship, you know, to kind of get it done. So what used to initially happen was that everyone would kind of, there'd be a release date set, everyone kind of push into one big release, and that would create this one massive release that had to go out on a single day. And as you can imagine, that caused a whole lot of problems, and we actually took that live. Brief touch upon our tech stack. So we're mainly a Python workshop. There's RapidMQ in the middle for handling async messages and message processing. We use Celery as a consumer for RapidMQ. There's MQTT as a message delivery system. We have 3 or 4 different databases, Mongo, Elasticsearch, MySQL. So it's a pretty deep tech stack in that sense, because we, as a chatbot, we have to kind of be present in every sort of platform. So it has to be on iOS, Android, web, it has to be on Facebook, Slack, a whole bunch of other platforms, right? So in that sense, the number of technologies we have today with also is quite a bit. So this is where we were a lot, like, you know, when we started out, that there is bi-monthly releases happening where 7 or 8 teams have put together their code on the staging environment, and they're trying to, you know, get things stable, and QA trying to test things so that we can ship it. And when so many teams commit so much to the same, they all merge it into develop at the same time, you can see that something's broken. It's extremely hard to figure out now whose code broke what. And then you're trying to debug multiple features, you're trying to roll back ones that don't work, just so that, you know, you have like some feature which is delaying everyone else's release now, because you can't even figure out what happened. This always used to result in delays, and then even though you'd fix things on staging, you'd release on production, you'd see, hey, now there's 5 other things that are broken. And it's a lot of firefighting, it's sort of an all-hands effort that used to happen when we released code. And even after the production release was done, you'd realize that someone on some other team has included some other package, someone has included some other, put in some OS level dependencies, and the other teams now don't know about it. And when they pull master back into their branches, they realize now the development environments are out of sync and they're breaking as well. So it's absolute kind of chaos for us, and we realize, you know, hey, we gotta do something about this. We gotta make sure that we can ship code faster and a whole lot easier than it is now. So, you know, when we started out, we said, okay, what are we trying to achieve here? What are the goals that we want for this entire system, right? So first thing that we started was it had to have zero downtime. Downtime at any point of the day, migrations, be what it may, it's not acceptable to us as a company. Even in the middle of the night, we have a certain number of users online, and their service and their cannot be interrupted for any reason. We want to change from, you know, those batched large releases to little high frequency, low risk deployments, and that kind of results in the third point, fourth point, right, which is basically your integration problems get minimized. If you're shipping code a lot faster, you realize, okay, hey, it's just my code that's gone out today, right now, and you know, whatever went wrong, it has to be related to that, not related to five other things that went live at the same time. So the moment you ship faster, your integration problems also immediately kind of get minimized over there. One of the things also, if you're to manage all the dependencies, and have that present somewhere in like the same place, all our installations that we did, any OS level installations that we did, that also has to be automated, right? If someone else in some other team installs something, it should be available to everyone now. It should be documented somewhere, it should be available. And the last point is actually something more of a thought process, you know, that we want to have developers have. So engineers, you know, would just build something, they pass it on and throw it over the fence, like, hey, go release this, it's not my problem anymore. And that's just, you know, culturally not something that we want. We want people to be responsible and owning that code right from conception right to the moment it goes into production. And that creates a sort of culture of ownership that, hey, even if something went wrong in production, it could be an infra level problem, it could be anything, right? I'm still responsible for it. I wrote this code and I'm responsible for shipping this code now. And that sort of mindset needed to come in. So we took a shot at it, and this is kind of the first version of what we ended up at from the ACI pipeline. What we started out with is, you can see, we gave each developer their own sort of siloed development environment. They pull out a feature branch, and when they were ready, they build on that feature branch, they clear a PR against develop. We're following Git flow here, so I don't know if you guys are kind of aware, but I hope everyone's kind of in the know about Git flow. So we create the develop branch, and develop branch was deployed on the staging environment. Whenever a developer hit a branch up of develop, clear a feature branch, and once the PR was good to go, we merge it into develop, and we go on a Jenkins and just hit deploy. The Jenkins would go on to the staging environment, pull in the latest code, run the kind of package installations that were there, the dependencies, all that stuff, take care of that. And that would kind of push the latest code a whole lot easier onto the staging environment. What you see over here in the yellow arrows are actually the configurations of the entire server. That would actually be hosted on S3, so anytime anyone would add a new sort of dip package or a new OS level dependency, a new environment variable for configuration, they just go ahead and add it there. We build a little tool around it to make that easier. Once that was done, you know, that environment file had its own versions for development, for staging, and for the dev server. So anyone else could just go in and run a command on their dev server, and they get the latest version of the environment file. So all the configurations would kind of get pushed up to them. What you see here in the purple arrows are actually the configurations of the environment itself. So say, for example, you are building Valentine's Day, or Valentine's Day is coming up now. You just go in and for each blue, every sort of platform building tool, you go in and sort of add whatever data you wanted, you build that bot out, you add all the copies, you configure how you want it to be deployed, how you want it to run. You just push that on, and that would actually be available on every single environment. And you could, you know, kind of deploy a bot wherever you wanted to. So that was kind of where we ended up with on the first shot that we gave it, but I don't know if you can see we missed out on something really, really crucial. So we didn't perform testing as part of our CI pipeline, and that just fucked it up to another level, right? It's just what ended up happening was that you're just shipping more code now, but that's still bad code. And we're just breaking staging more and more often. Every day staging would go down a couple of hours because someone wrote code which didn't have tests, which wasn't tested out. I actually think it initially made things a lot worse. And this was a very immediate realization that you just can't have CI without tests. You can't think we're having a pipeline where you're pushing code at that level of frequency on an hourly basis without having testing to make sure you haven't broken anything else. And this became kind of a problem for us, right? Because here we have this very large code base already. Now you go back and start writing coverage, and now start writing tests, you have increased the coverage. How do you bring in that culture of, hey, this is the value of tests right now? And this is not just the developers right now. You've got to convince PMs whose timelines are sort of affected. You've got to let them know that, hey, every sort of feature you write, you ship now, has to have a testing philosophy to it. It has to have not just code that ships, but also a set of tests with it. So we actually had to start going backwards now and start writing tests for, like, you know, at least for key components, payments, user registration, bunch of those things. Another key point that we missed out on was the focus that we should have on data. There was several data that was being entered and duplicated across multiple environments. One of the key things was chat data, basically. So the machine learning models that we had, the data that was being trained on would have to be re-entered across every environment. Or a developer would have to kind of figure out how to manually move that across. So the bot would then end up behaving differently in every environment, in every single environment. Even the configuration data of the bot itself, what are the responses, what is the flow of the bot, what channels is it deploying on, keys, API keys, all of those things would then have to be sort of moved across environments. That would not be a very big problem. Especially for us, we had to realize that shipping code for us and shipping data were actually on the same level. Sometimes you just need to ship a new model, you need to ship new responses, and it was just as important as the code. It was the first class reason. You cannot ignore the data that has to move across every environment when you build this sort of pipeline. And not only data moving from dev to stage into production, but then again back to dev as again other people are building other features, other data is going in, that has to be available now for all developers to work on. And you also have to make sure that, you know, there are no conflicts. If two people are working on the same thing and they kind of make the same edits from different places, you can't have that data collide with each other and suddenly you have multiple versions of the same thing. There has to be some sort of conflict resolution for this data as well. So, you know, data has to be given that level one importance when you build a CI pipeline. It's not just about code moving from A to B. The data has to move with it error-free. So this is kind of the learnings from the first version of our pipeline was, right, that there's chaos in the staging environment. And that becomes your key testing environment. It keeps going down. That cannot happen. You have to make sure that the staging environment is hardened and protected from any sort of immediate errors. And sure, you have some sort of bugs over there which you might need to kind of go in, but at least those are not large critical ones which kind of bring down the entire environment. One more thing was, you know, we realized that this is not just us setting up Jenkins and getting on with it, right? It's a set of culture now that has to come in. You know, think from that perspective that, hey, I need to set up this process is in place, I need to set up and get a mindset that, okay, now I need to write tests, I need to ship in this fashion, I need to make sure that developers in block for some other release, and you need to make happy to work in test-driven development fashion. So that culture almost took actually a few months for us to build in. The tools came up pretty easily, we got Jenkins set up and everything set up within days, weeks. But changing the mindset of everyone when they're used to working in a certain way, that took a long time. We also experimented a bit with the pre-prod environment. So that was between the staging and production. We thought it would just be another sort of sanity test that could run there. You know, as something got ready from developed, you deploy your release branch onto pre-prod, and then before we went on to production. But again, given the way that the data wasn't moving and the fact that staging itself was going down, this became just another environment that went down fairly often. So we scrapped that and we just, you know, tried to focus on having the current set of environments working the way they were. key question kind of you ask yourself whenever you build something like this is that it has to give you confidence. It shouldn't make you more nervous that, you know, more people are shipping code. You have to have the confidence to say that, hey, you know, this code that's going out, it's shipping actually faster and with higher level of reliability. You want to be more involved in every release. You can't obviously be more involved in every release and say that, hey, let me handhold every single release that goes out there, because now you're not doing twice a month, you're doing it every single hour. And if it requires some sort of personal involvement, like, hey, this isn't working, that isn't working, it's not going to work out, you know. You're not going to have a real CI pipeline. So, we decided, you know, revisit the entire thing. Decided, hey, let's give this another shot, let's rework this entire thing, let's grab what we have now. Let's see what we need to focus on or build upon from the previous version of our CI pipeline. So, the first thing was obviously we had to build out tests, right? We had to kind of have those test blocking merges, test blocking releases, and really testing anything before it went out. And it had to be a fair enough amount of coverage that, you know, you could kind of just not worry about it and be hands-off of this entire thing. You'd be hands-off in terms of what goes out there. That'd be a consistency across every environment in terms of data, in terms of code, in terms of configuration. That had to be maintained and enforced on a very strict level, because you don't want that breaking your code even from staging to production. And QA time was also actually kind of starting to creep up, so that we didn't have something also hopefully automated testing would help figure out. So this is the second version kind of where we landed up. Walk you guys through now basically what it takes to ship, build a feature and then kind of ship it to production. So, a developer will start out on his own development server. He branch out a feature branch of the staging environment of develop, and he'll build out his feature over there. Once, you know, he's made all his changes, the feature is good to go, he'll create a pull request, and that pull request will on GitHub will automatically be taken. It will be deployed on a test environment. On the test environment, all the tests will run, and the results of the test will actually be attached to the PR along with code coverage, as the coverage of the entire code base has increased or decreased based on the code and the tests added in that PR. And it was kind of labeled, you know, on every GitHub you'd see all the labels there, code coverage above 80, below 80, adding coverage, below coverage. And this actually created, you know, like a huge psychological impact, because all developers are going there, like, you know, do code reviews. And suddenly they can see whose PRs adding coverage, whose PRs reducing coverage, is the coverage good, are the tests passing, and that made everyone more motivated to write more tests, that, hey, I'm contributing to improving the coverage of the entire code base. So GitHub, from GitHub we pull and we run these tests automatically. Once those were good to go and those pass and the PR was approved, from Jenkins would now we had the confidence right on staging that, hey, this PR is good to go, it's not gonna break anything. We could then automatically deploy, and once that PR got launched, we could just deploy that code automatically on staging. So we had continuous deployment or staging at that point where it would just deploy the latest code, we didn't have to worry about it. We brought in for our production deployments a service called Spotinst. So I don't know if you guys are familiar with Spotinst. It's a great tool, it's a great company. So a quick touch upon Spot servers on AWS. Basically, there's servers over compute workloads that you can run on demand at a much, much cheaper rate. The only caveat is that AWS can take these servers back from you at any point. So, if you have workloads which are, you know, stateless and, you know, you can just afford having servers come up and down, it's a great, great way to save cost. And what Spotinst does for you is that it will bid for these servers for you automatically. You say, I need 10 servers running at any time. Spotinst goes, bids for these servers for you at the lowest cost it can. It deploys these servers for you. The moment a server goes down and you get about 30 seconds notification that a server is going to go down, it will bid for another server for you and replace the existing server that just went down. So you will, it will maintain a certain level of sort of these things for you. It handles scaling, it handles blueprint deployments to make sure you don't have downtime. It offers a lot of great things outside the box, and it has a great algorithm to make sure that you're also saving a whole lot of money. So you say that, hey, I can run workloads on either T2, T2 large, info large, whatever it is, a set of servers that are compatible for your application. You will add those lists and then pick the cheapest among those based on the current market ups and downs that the Spot servers have. So we built in Spot to release to production, and it will just kind of make sure that, you know, our deployments went, I'll dig deeper into the deployment itself in a bit as to how that sort of would go in there, and just pull in the latest and make sure that we were running an entire workload with Spotless. There's some changes here to the purple arrows that you can see. Basically, this is just now a single ingress point for all configuration. So staging would be that you would actually enter all the data for our bots, all the models, all the copies of the models, the training data for the chat bots, the chat flows, and kind of how those are interconnected. Those would all go into the staging environment. And from the staging environment, we transfer it to production. So you could actually not change anything in production directly. You have to first go back to staging, change what you have wanted to make, and then transfer it to production. So it became a sort of sandbox on testing environment for us. Now let's say, you know, there's a certain question or a certain phrase for which the bot is not able to reply on production. We automatically pull that data out. We move it to another data tagging service, which will then be presented to all our assistants and operational team across all of the bots. They'll be like, hey, the bot is not replying because this data is missing, this data is not tagged correctly. They automatically will just hit and be able to kind of mark out the entire text with all the missing entities, and then again push that back to staging. Then we would test the new model on staging. And then again, the same way that data, that those models will be pushed after that into production. The infrastructure configuration piece for us kind of remains largely the same that was working fairly well now. We moved into recently a new service called EMB Key that helps us kind of manage the environment keys across multiple environments. It has like a fairly nice console and some security configuration to hide that those environment keys from anyone who logs into the server as well. This is the deployment process that we followed. From Jenkins, you go ahead, you hit deploy. And we have all these scripts written in Ansible, so it's just Ansible Marco there. And the way it worked is all our entire workload was on Spotinst. So these Spot servers were going up and down 700 times a day. There would be one on demand server, which was a template of that entire type of server. So if you had your web servers, you'd have one on-demand server for your web servers, you have one on-demand server for your, say, your salary workers, which are running separately. So every type of server has one on-demand server. Now, when you want to make a deployment, you'd take that one server out of circulation, you'd take it out of the load balancer, or you would have it, the salary that is stopped. You would install whatever requirements or any sort of packages that you had needed to be installed on that. That information was now pushed into the repository itself. You go and pull the latest code on that server. And if there were any migrations that were to be done, it would run it at that point. You bring that one server back up. Mind you, it's still not in the load balancer, it's still not taking any production workload. You just want to run basic sanity at that point to make sure that, you know, the code that's actually being pushed on the production now, it's good, it's solid. We've already tested it, the VR, we've already tested it on staging, but we're going to run the final check on production as well. After that, when you enter what is called as the rollout phase, that server we create an AMI of, a machine image, and then from there we take that machine image ID. The server has to shut down for creating the AMI. After that, you take that AMI ID that was created, you pass it to Spotinst. Spotinst is now going to run a blueprint deployment. It will start shutting, it will start bringing up servers with the new AMI, the new code base, new installations automatically, and once those servers are live and working well, it will kill the old servers. initial on-demand server back into the load balancer, bring that back up. So, I mean, the key reason to have that on-demand server there is that you know where to go to for your deployment, because the spot server might be there, might not be there, you don't know what's the date. It could even go down halfway through your deployment or your release process, and you don't want that. So you want at least just one on-demand server there, so you know where you're deploying your code. So that was kind of, you know, the CI pipeline that we built for our backend. We went ahead and did the whole same thing for our mobile apps as well, and the SDKs that we have. That was a more straightforward process. We wrote unit tests, we wrote integration tests. Those tests were run in CircleCI every single night. They were written in Selenium, and the integration tests were a bit slow, but they did the job. Every night they, on the develop branch itself, they would run the entire test loop. We get the result in the morning that, hey, this worked, this didn't work. Let's go fix this. And the same way, unit tests were run on every PR, and you know, you couldn't even merge that code into develop unless all the tests passed. The details were sent to the entire team, so you know, they could just test out this current status of whatever features out there. How's it working? How's it looking? You don't have to go ask developers, hey, can I get a build? What's the status? Can I test this? Can I test that? Everyone just had the latest build, and you know, developers don't have to waste time making that build every time. So one thing we realized is that, you know, we had these large component sets, but a unique challenge for us was actually testing the entire chatbot itself, right? That's something I think industry-wide a lot of people are struggling with, that each time you make changes to something fundamental, you gotta go in, you gotta start typing, and you gotta start chatting with the chatbot, and you're like, is it working now? And that's extremely time-consuming. I mean, across several dozen, we're touching on 50, 60, 70 bots now, it's not possible. Especially, we're not talking about changes just to that particular bot or that particular chat flow. There are some changes which are more fundamental. So when you change the type of model you're using, that's going to impact every sort of bot out there. And you have to test everything again, and that takes days, absolutely. And again, this was actually a unique challenge for us to figure out how to test this, because you can't just test input and validate against output, because that's also changing. The copies that you have in the chatbot, the responses you get back, those are being constantly tweaked by product managers, by content guys. You cannot see what works best, so you can't rely on those copies as well. So we figured out a way to be able to test the flow of a bot based on just logic and keeping aside copies and content. So we made it content agnostic, that it would just say, hey, I ended up at point A, I put this text input, and where did I land up across sort of the graph as to when I traversed against it. And keeping that sort of data as to X input, Y output for basically graph traversal, we were able to create a template for testing chat flows. So that even when we make, you know, code changes to how chatbot works, we can just test it, see if this is still working, and make sure, you know, nothing breaks in production. So, you know, these are things that kind of work for us largely. Our teams at least have completed their own independent release cycles. They are able to, you know, ship code whenever they want. A developer will, like I said, is, you know, takes it and is able to get the release button to take it all the way to production. And in that case, you know, when something goes wrong, when he's shipped that code, he's going to be on top of it. He's going to make sure that, something's gone wrong in production, let me go and check it, even though I might not be responsible for, you know, uptime. So that ownership really came out, and it really, really helped improve the sort of code quality that went out. The number of bugs also we saw now in production, far, far less. Downtime, very, very infrequent. Actually, we haven't seen a downtime since then. It's taken that manual overhead and coordination also completely out of every sort of single release. And apps, as I mentioned, are hardened every day. And also the machine learning team can fool around and try out different sort of models to make sure that this is still working, and you still have that flexibility of trying different models out. So, you know, this is also one of the key takeaways that we had, that, you know, people never get focused about, hey, should I use LinkedIn, should I use the share, should I use this, should I use that. It's use what works for you. It all works fantastically well, it all works great, and don't get bogged down by these tools of like, hey, Ansible doesn't do this, etc., etc., right? It's the tools, all of them will get the job done fairly well. Focus on how you're actually taking and the culture that takes CI from A to B, like how you're actually going to ship this. Talk to not just your engineers, but also everyone else involved in the process, right? Because they are also impacted, their timelines are impacted. It's almost a company-wide cultural change that needs to happen. The tools, just pick your favorite. And you know, this is just sort of where we are right now. So I think a couple of things we're striving for as we move ahead. We're going to try and increase our coverage, of course, and non-functional coverage, as I like to call it. Not just coverage for the sake of coverage. A unit test should be testing against something of actual business value. It's actually validating something. Not just checking that things are not failing from a period perspective. Continuous deployments is something that you have live on staging where you don't even have to worry about when it releases, it just releases. That would be great to have in production as well once we have that further level of confidence. We'll probably add API testing to kind of automate that, kind of add that further level of validation that nothing is going down. And this is something I've actually been thinking of in terms of, you know, how can we further harden the system and make sure the bot's actually growing in intelligence, right? Where we have basically just a huge corpus of user responses that we fetch out from a historic data that we have, and we just throw it at the bot. We just randomly keep throwing things at the bot and make sure that nothing is breaking the set of answers that we have, the questions that we have, just are constantly doing. So those sort of a chaos monkey chatbot sort of thing is what we're going to build our things. Yeah, I think that's it from my end. Thanks for your time.